Christ. So as well as it being Ascension Day, today we mark the beginning of Thy Kingdom Come, which is 10 days of continuous prayer from Ascension Day through to Pentecost Sunday. And this is prayer for God's kingdom to touch earth, for injustices to be broken through, and for all kinds of bonds, things that keep people in oppression, to be just smashed completely, and most of all, for new life to come as people connect with who Jesus is and who they can be as they say yes to his life in their lives. So on your seats you've got a booklet, you've got a journal booklet, which is just to help you to reflect on various things during Thy Kingdom Come, and just each day to take more of an active interest in just journaling and thinking through, praying, and letting the Holy Spirit inspire you as you do that. And then the other booklet is called the Novena, which is praying through the Psalms. And so I just encourage you to make the most of those resources. And you'll also notice that on your seats you've got a thread that is going to be made use of later on in the service this evening. So during Easter season, we've been celebrating over these past 7 weeks that Jesus rose again, but he didn't stay dead, that he rose victorious over sin and over death, that he brought new life through rising to everyone who would be open to his life. He burst from the tomb, he defeated all of that power that was in sin, all of that power that was in death. And now we remember that Jesus returned to his Father, that he ascended into heaven to take his throne over all dominions and powers with Father God, and that he will return again. And we're going to start off right at the beginning of our service by looking at a reading that Margaret's going to bring to us from Acts 1, 4 to 11.
On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you'll be baptized with the Holy Spirit." Then they gathered around him and asked, "Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel?" He said to them, "It is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witness in Jerusalem and in all Judea, Samaria, and to the end of the earth." After he said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid them from their sight. They were looking intently up to the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. "Men of Galilee," they said, "why do you stand here looking into the sky? This same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way he has gone up to heaven." This is the word of the Lord. Amen.
At the forefront of our thinking, that we respond with the words in our time. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Lord Jesus, we rejoice in your glorious resurrection. We rejoice that you reign over all creation. And we choose in this moment to come before you in adoration with hearts full of praise, because we recognise that you are worthy, God. In your glorious name, amen. So we've got two songs, and although we can't yet sing inside, encourage us to just be free in this time, if you want to stand, if you want to lift your hands, and whatever, and that's completely fine. It's Lord, I lift your name on high, we start with.
Okay.
to be open to you in this service, but right at the start of thy kingdom come, for your glory. Amen. So we've got our third Bible reading. Is it going to bring to us?
And this final reading is from Luke chapter 24, verses 44 to the end. He said to them, "This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms." Then he opened their minds so they could understand the scriptures. He told them, "This is what is written: the Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day. And repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. I am going to send you what my Father has promised. But stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high." When he led them out to the vicinity of Bethany, he lifted up his hands and blessed them. While he was blessing them, he left them and was taken up into heaven. Then they worshipped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy. And they stayed continually in the temple, praising God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Got an opportunity now to watch a video that's been made especially for this year's Thy Kingdom Come. And it's a prayer this sung, that God's presence will spread into every street, into every neighbourhood that is in the world. So let's watch this with anticipation.
Thank you.
will forgive us for those times when we've been slow to engage, Lord, slow to notice, Lord, when we have failed to be people through whom you can inscribe your heart on history's page. And Lord, make us to be open to your word tonight as we come to explore what you could be saying to each and every one of us. For your glory, Jesus. Amen. So often in the history of the church's life, the ascension of Jesus Christ has been mistaken as having been something that just happened to take Jesus out of a position of being actively involved with what was going on in the world. And yet that couldn't be further from the truth. Jesus did ascend to the right hand of the Father, but his authority continued. Jesus' ascension and lordship is active. It's energetic. It's continuous. His influence continues, and in a mighty way, through each of his disciples who will rely upon him. And that's what we read in verse 11 of Acts 1, that the two men dressed in white said simply to the disciples around at the time, "Why do you stand here looking into the sky? Why are you looking into the sky? This same Jesus who you have seen be taken from you into heaven will come back in exactly the same way as you saw him go." When we consider that verse in the context of Luke passage, as well as other parts of the New Testament, we understand that the men in white were in effect saying, "Why aren't you getting on with it? Why aren't you getting on with this task of sharing the good news?" No doubt further conversations went on between the early disciples of Jesus that were very much along those lines. In the hymn, "There is a Redeemer" by Keith Green, but I know so many of our congregation are familiar with, there's that final verse that says, "Thank you, O my Father, for giving us your Son and leaving your Spirit till the work on earth is done." And that's where we are right now in our church's year. That's what we're focusing upon. Tonight, near the end of Ascension Day, we remember that the Easter season came to an end. That time of Jesus being physically with his disciples, appearing to them, following his victory over sin and the grave, that came to an end. A time for his physical presence to be with them, it did finish. And the time came for them to wait for the Holy Spirit of God to come upon them, to fill them to overflowing, to give them the power to be able to carry Jesus' message of forgiveness and new life to the whole entire world. That wasn't in any way an ending. It was just the beginning. Jesus told his first followers, and we read in verse 47 of Luke 24, "Repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are my witnesses of these things, but stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high." Being Jesus' witnesses, bearers of his great, mighty good news through what we say and what we do, is the highest calling that we can ever have. And as church, during this time of COVID-19, we're to start, we're in these days, we're to start imagining how it is that we can be increasingly a movement of disciples, not people simply who come to church, but a movement of disciples faced with the challenge. about connecting with others in a meaningful way because of the pandemic. I believe that God wants to make us more truly alive to this amazing work that He has for us, to truly wake us up more to it. Just like Cleopas and his companion who met Jesus on the road to Emmaus, we too are to allow our minds to be opened to what it means for us to be those witnesses, open to the meaning of the scriptures that would lead us so much further than ourselves, beyond ourselves, to people who are around us. The resurrected life of Jesus Christ reveals that there isn't anything that can bind or overtake that grace that is given to us through His resurrection, the unconditional love, the unconditional forgiveness and life. And that is, I think, one of the most difficult things for you and me, for all of us, to really comprehend, to see, to believe, to live into, that this is a reality that we can have, that we can be living in. But it is the glorious reality that we are all invited to participate in. We're not to be passive, here and now, in Bramhalls and Clayhanger, wherever we work and with whoever we interact with. Being followers of Jesus who are His witnesses to His love and life, doesn't mean that we have to have all of the answers. It just means that we're to be open to how Jesus would want to flow through us to others. Our witness is based on who we are in God, not who we are apart from God. How we speak and live because of Him, not because of ourselves. And our relationship, our deep and meaningful relationship with the risen Lord Jesus. Being Jesus' witnesses happens when we risk unbinding ourselves from the usual ways of seeing, living and relating. That's what happened for the earliest disciples when they saw Him on those different occasions after His resurrection. They saw and they recognised something about Jesus, and in so doing they saw and they recognised something about themselves. Holiness, love, life, power, that they could be linked with His life. And I wonder if you can think for a moment about a time in your life when you sense something new being offered to you. Or maybe a time when you thought there were possibilities arising that you could never have thought would have been made of your own doing. It's moments like that when we realise that those new things are on the horizon that are most like what it is when Jesus opens our minds and our hearts to understand. They are the moments when we sense God's holiness, the warmth of His love, the empowerment of His Spirit to be able to face something, to overcome, to break through. Those moments might, and often do, bring us to tears. But not tears of sadness, say tears of deep joy, excitement, anticipation. We're overwhelmed by the amazing power of the Spirit. And this evening, and in each of these 9 days that are leading up to Pentecost, I know for sure that God wants us all to experience those moments of being affected by His presence in a way that we just can't shake off. Marking the time when Jesus ascended to be with the Father, tonight each of us can, just as those very first disciples did, we can worship, we can joyfully wait, and we can receive the Holy Spirit. because he said, "You are witnesses of his things." He said that to those early disciples, and so we know for sure that he's saying that to us tonight. And from our Acts chapter 1 reading, I sense that God might be calling each of us to think more deeply about what it would mean for us to enter more fully into being his witnesses. Exploring our Acts 1 reading, we understand that our witness for Jesus has a great deal to do with our ownership of his witness. Again, like so many things in God's kingdom, it's an active, it's an intentional thing. We need to take ownership and say, "I want to be a witness. I want to take responsibility to be a witness for you, Jesus." So the question is, how far are we willing to go for Jesus? How much do we want to really be those channels through whom his spirit can flow to others? As the evangelist Luke records in Acts 1, Jesus appeared to those first disciples over a period of 40 days and spoke to them about God's kingdom. We read in verse 4 that on one occasion, Jesus told them that they needed to receive the Spirit before leaving Jerusalem. And not content to simply accept that, those first followers then asked Jesus whether he was going to bring restoration about to their own nation. And that might be a question that we've got tonight, with all that's been lost through the pandemic, through everything that we have experienced because of COVID-19. We might want to ask God, how is that healing, how is that restoration going to happen for our lives, for the lives of those we love that have been negatively impacted? But to do that would really be to miss the whole point of Jesus' message to those early followers, because in verses 7 to 11, Jesus shifts the onus onto them. Once again, it's about ownership, responsibility. Jesus tells them plainly that it's their witness, not all of the questions that they might have about how the restoration can happen, how a healing can come. Jesus says, "You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on who? You." These days of Thy Kingdom Come are a precious, a unique opportunity for each of us to talk to God, even as we read his words in the Bible, about our witness for Jesus. They're an opportunity for us to take seriously who Jesus is calling us to be in our lives. They're an opportunity for us to ask God to fill us so that we will be people who carry that power for his glory. Even before the day of Pentecost comes, we can be doing each of those things. So we're going to go now into a time of waiting and quietness. I'll just encourage us all to be open to the Holy Spirit of God, just listening to God for any promptings that he would want to give to us about our witness for Jesus. Father God, we are open to you. So we say, Holy Spirit, come, show us, Lord, highlight anything to us that you want us to be aware of. as I was saying, it's very much that the Lord is calling for us to respond. So if you want to say tonight that you would be a witness for Jesus, that you want to take ownership of being a witness, take responsibility for being a witness. And if you're comfortably able, would you stand just where you are? Just in your own time. Don't hold back if you know that the Lord is calling you to be a witness. Lord, Heavenly Father God, we just thank you for each person who has made this step tonight of standing as an outward sign that they want to be witnesses to Jesus' power to forgive and to save. Lord, bless them, Almighty Father. Thank you for the risk that they've taken. Pour out your Holy Spirit into their hearts, Lord, that they will come to care far, far more about what you think of them than what anyone else does. Lord, fill them with your overwhelming, never-ending love. Give them your great transcendent peace this evening and in these days to come leading up to Pentecost. Lord, keep on giving to each one of these your servants the power of your Holy Spirit, that they will speak up about the name of Jesus. May each one of them know that it is them specifically that you were speaking about when you said that they would receive power to be your witnesses to the ends of the earth. In Jesus' wonderful name. Amen. Around and I would read that you've all stood up and just commend you for that, and I pray that you will carry that with you as you go home and continue just speaking to God about that and what that means for you. So part of our kingdom come is to focus upon people in our lives who don't yet know the life and the forgiveness of Jesus. So you've each got a thread, and so just help us to know a bit more about what this is all about. We're going to watch a very short clip.
A great preacher called D.L. Moody, who had 100 friends who didn't know Jesus that he prayed for every day, and when one of them became a Christian, he would just tick their name off the list. By the time he died, 96 of those 100 had given their lives to Jesus. And at his funeral, the final 4 also became Christians. There's such power in praying for our friends who don't yet know Jesus. In not just doing it once in a while or when we feel like it, but regularly, persevering with discipline. And so I'm going to tie these 5 knots in this leather strap and wear it to remind myself of just 5 friends I know who I want to come to know the good news of Jesus.
So I'm just going to take a few moment now to bring to mind five people, and like the family members, friends, people we know for work, and just tie five knots and then put that around our wrist, basically. She's going to come up now and lead us just in a few prayers. And we can respond on the screen too.
Rejoicing that Jesus has ascended into the heavens, let us pray in confidence to God our Father. We pray in thankfulness for those who introduced us to Jesus and who help us along our spiritual journey. We pray for one another in this church and for all Christians, young and old, throughout the world. Let the kingdom come, let your kingdom. We pray with longing for the world to be governed in accordance with your law of love, that all your creation may be reverenced and treated with respect. Let the kingdom come, let your kingdom come. We pray with concern for all the homes, schools and places of work in this community, rejoicing in all that is of you, and asking your healing forgiveness wherever there is discord or bitterness. Let the kingdom come, let your kingdom come. We pray with hope for the healing and restoration to wholeness of all who are ill or troubled, damaged or depressed. Let the kingdom come, let your kingdom come. We pray with confidence for those who have come to the end of their earthly lives, that they may be given merciful judgment and welcomed into the glory of heaven. Let the kingdom come, let your kingdom come. We pray with joy as we celebrate Jesus entering the glory he so richly deserves and look expectantly towards his second coming. God of our salvation, hope of all the ends of the earth, we pray, your kingdom come. That the world may know Jesus as the Prince of Peace, we pray, let your kingdom come. That we may be bold to speak the word of God while you stretch out your hand to save, we pray, your kingdom come. That the church may be generous in giving, faithful in service and serving, bold in proclaiming, we pray, your kingdom come. That the day may come when every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. We pray in your kingdom. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
And we'll move into those five individuals that we've started to bring before you. And pray, Lord, that each time that we look this Friday around our waist, we'd be reminded of them and be motivated each day for these next 9 days to just keep on praying for you to connect with them or to do what only you can do. In your mighty name. Amen. I'm going to light this candle now, which is going to be lit every day in church, during Bible Nicol. And as we look at that candle as a reminder of the light of Jesus Christ, let's pray together the prayer that our Saviour has taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We approach celebrating Holy Communion, we're going to reflect on this song, I have no one in heaven but you.
I have no one in heaven but you.
greeting me today, those through whom your kingdom comes. In Jesus' name, Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all creation. In your love you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son. You embraced us as your children, and welcomed us to sit and eat with you. In Christ you shared our life, that we might live in him and he in us. He opened his arms of love upon the cross, and made for all the perfect sacrifice for sin. On the night that he was betrayed at supper with his friends, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life. And at the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, who is in the midst of him, his blood shed for all. As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit, that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son. As we eat and drink this holy feast, make us born of Christ, our risen Lord. With your whole church throughout the world, we offer the sacrifice of praise and lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body. Because we all share in one of them.
So it's all on time.
Lord Heavenly Father, thank you for the awesome privilege of being able to celebrate Holy Communion, to receive your life from it. And we humbly pray that you would remain with us as we stay with you, as we make that choice to stay with you. Would you remain with us so that we can remember those people we've committed to pray for, and we can just keep on listening to you about the witnesses that you would make us into. In Jesus' name, amen. And finish with a song of praise. So once again, if you would like to stand or clap or whatever, then do so. Thank you.
Pauline's going to put